Jazz has been such a patriarchal community from the beginning that it's hard for people to see it any other way. But what would the music sound like if many of the contributors were women?
Because the music itself is gendered, the music has never been allowed to reach its own potential.
Some people would say, well, there just weren't enough women around. But what we have to look at is the machinery, social, economic, political, that didn't allow those voices to flourish.
The jazz industry, which has been predominantly male, has echoed the biased system from which it emerged. So what would jazz sound like in a culture without patriarchy?
Justice is indivisible, as Dr. King said. Racial justice and gender justice are linked.
Berklee has been a very supportive environment to female instrumentalists for a long time, from Toshiko Akiyoshi to Esperanza Spalding. So it makes sense that Berklee would be in the forefront of gender equity with jazz and other genres.
You know, what would jazz sound like? Performed without bias, without patriarchy, is not a question where we should answer it by coming up with words to tell us what it should sound like. It's precisely the work the music will do. But we have to make it possible for that music to get made.
We started Berklee Institute of Jazz and Gender Justice to address these issues and to create a safe and nurturing environment for people of all gender identification to study jazz.
Jazz really has played a major role in transformations.
This is a beautiful start to making the music even more radical, inclusive, and to make it a space for justice.
Thank you so much. I am just thrilled to be here with you all this morning, to have been asked to deliver opening remarks on this occasion, the open house for the Institute of Jazz and Gender Studies here at Berklee. And I want to congratulate my dear, dear sister friend, the visionary Terri Lyne Carrington, and I want to thank and congratulate Managing Director Asia Burrell Wood for all of her tireless work and emails and organizing and getting us all here together. And I want to congratulate Berklee for supporting Terri Lyne's visionary leadership. The Berklee Institute of Jazz and Gender Justice asked us to envision what jazz would look like without, sound like without patriarchy. It says, what would jazz sound like in a culture without patriarchy? This is a huge question and a brilliant one. So let's spend a little time on two specific words and phrases, the phrases that contain them. The first word is gender in gender justice, and the second is patriarchy in culture without patriarchy. The work of achieving gender justice is not women's work, and it doesn't benefit only women. Gender justice implies a politic whereby boys and girls, men and women, cis and transgender, and gender nonconforming and non-binary persons, where everyone is valued equally and share in an equitable distribution of power, knowledge, and resources. We all benefit from that. To say that the work of gender justice is everyone's work or benefits everyone is not to take our eyes on the very specific need to address gender-based violence and discrimination. This is, of course, fundamental to the achievement of gender justice. Women in jazz and beyond are disproportionately the victims of discrimination, harassment, and assault. This is even more so for women of color and poor women. Furthermore, they are denied work, opportunities for career advancement, for recognition for their achievement and their contribution. And these realities, realities they are, prohibit many talented women from reaching their full potential in their chosen art form and in the broader world. The work of eliminating these inequities is the work of everyone, and it cannot be achieved by women alone. The Institute states that it seeks to, quote, do corrective work, modify the way jazz is perceived and presented by focusing on equity in the jazz field, and in the role that jazz plays in the larger struggle for gender justice. This means celebrating women's contributions, but also framing more equitable conditions, quote, for pursuing careers in jazz. This is the work of transforming jazz culture, and in so doing, in transforming jazz culture, we are helping to build a more just world. Since its inception, jazz has helped to build a better and more just world. And later in my remarks, I will talk specifically about how it has done so. But with projects like that of this institute, it can build upon this tradition of social justice and help to transform itself and our world in the arena of gender as well. If patriarchy is so deeply entrenched in our society, in our world, can jazz lead a way toward dismantling it? It's a tall order, a large task, but I don't think it's impossible. The Institute of Jazz and Gender Justice asks that we at least have a vision of a music free of patriarchy, that we imagine it, that we have what the historian Robin Kelly calls freedom dreams. Then it asks that we establish a series of practices within our own institutions, our own communities, our own performance spaces. It offers to be a space that models these practices by welcoming, quote, students of all gender and sexual identities to achieve the goal of gender diversity in the field and by working to address gender inequities at the college through curriculum, recruitment, residencies, performances, research, and community engagement. If jazz culture at large takes up this mantle, follows this lead, I do think it can help lead the way towards societal transformation. The founding of an institution is always an invitation to join in the process of furthering human possibility and freedom, conditions under which this music we love will not only survive, but also thrive. In the time that remains, I want to return to art, because that is where we often best find imagined possibilities. We lost an extraordinary writer, poet, novelist, essayist, Ntozake Shange. Shange is best known as the author of the 1975 choreo poem for colored girls who have considered suicide when the rainbow is enough. In her first novel, Sassafras, Cypress, and Indigo, published in 1982, Shange presents women who are not only the lovers and wives of jazz musicians, but who are artists in their own right. But for our purposes, it is the baby sister, Indigo, who serves as the representative of Shange's own understanding of the music and its spiritual and political implications. And Indigo is a musician. She is a magic child. Shange tells us she has a moon coming from her mouth. She is a consort of the spirits, and she learns to allow them to speak through her, and especially through her music making. And she is a fiddler. Through Indigo, Shange gives us black musical genius in the form of a girl who is supported and nurtured by her community, who give her space and freedom and safety to just let her be. And through Indigo, Shange reminds us of the centrality of music to human aspirations for freedom. She insists that the artist must commune with ancestral spirits, but cannot remain amongst them. She must engage and transcend the beauty of the natural world and the tradition of her instrument. Shange demonstrates the necessity of discipline and practice, and I think she also gives us a vision of jazz without patriarchy. Here dwells the freedom-loving, freedom-singing notes of Indigo and the fugitive fiddlers of long ago. If Shange's work serves as a conduit for our longing, where notes fly free, throughout her body of work, music provides a map, a way out, a route toward that freedom. Her fictional musician girl child gives us a glimpse into jazz without patriarchy. But living women musicians and the men with whom they play are creating that world in reality. This institute asks us to imagine what jazz without patriarchy sounds like so we might build a music that strives for, aspires toward, and works to build a culture without patriarchy. As it so often does, art, especially music, can allow us to experience in the moment of performing and the moment of listening that world, free of barriers to the fullest expression of our humanity. I imagine that a jazz without patriarchy might sound like Indigo, and since she's a fictional character, she can sound like anything I want her to sound like. But I think she might also sound like this.
He'll be climbing that road.
Recognize the violinist. Anybody recognize the violinist?
Oh, yeah.
Is it Indigo? Okay, that's Regina Carter there. In 1999, Cassandra Wilson released an album inspired by Miles Davis's Traveling Miles. Whenever I think of Indigo, I read that novel, I hear Regina Carter. Miles was a proponent and beneficiary, and I would say victim also, of patriarchy. But he is nonetheless part of this lineage. He left us a legacy of beauty and ugliness, and here two extraordinary artists in an idiom that he helped to define claim and push that legacy and that music forward. And Regina's solo sounds like progress to me, moving up, if not forward, seven steps down that road, stepping in a direction I want to follow towards something approaching freedom. Thank you.
So Terri Lyne, do you want to kind of start with a statement on some of the concept, the initial concept? Oops.
I'm really turning this over to all of these amazing women here on this panel. And I think the bottom line is, I noticed there was a problem, and I eventually finally stepped in and did what I could. And I hadn't really been doing that all along. Yeah, just kind of woke up one day, had an awakening, and thought, well, the very least I can do is try to create a space here. And it just grew from there. Angela pointed out that justice needed to be in the title, and we went from there. And we're doing things outside of the college, of course, too. And right now, you know, we're just growing. It's only been about 3 years. We have six ensembles, liberal arts class, and our students have traveled to do performances. We have a book that I've been working on that will be coming out early next year, compositions by women composers. So there's corrective work involved, and I'm just trying to move the conversation forward. And also there's a lot of young men that gravitate, I would say, to our institute, because they recognize that it's their job too. Mm-hmm. And that they recognize that, I think they feel that they've had to perform a certain kind of masculinity that seems to be natural or normal on the jazz stage and in jazz culture. So a lot of young men are rejecting that. And I think that's very exciting right now.
You know, what are some of the other kind of modes and types of progress that you can push into vis-a-vis form, vis-a-vis gender ideation, vis-a-vis politics and activism, and vis-a-vis some of these practical things that need to happen to change the landscape. So what are these more what are examples of some of the projects that you all could take on to make all of this happen?
one of the things that I think is key, and I'd love to hear Gina's comments, Angela's comments, and certainly Farah for the way in which she's working as well. What are the questions that we actually need to ask now? Right? What does the Institute really need to be? So on the one hand, we understand the sort of general address, right? But then how does it function? How do we sort of employ research? How do we employ and engage teaching? How do we use the archive? How do we invite in other artists? And what are some of the questions that we actually need to be asking now that is related to a dynamic future?
I think, and this is something, you know, I think we've learned from past political movements, and we've certainly learned from artists, is how do we model in our own institutionalization, our own way of being? And I think Terri Lyne talked about that when she's talking about who comes to the Institute. How do we model in our own practice, our organizing practice, our political practice, our artistic practice, the world that we're fighting to bring into being? You know, that I think is a set of questions that we want to address. Are we doing that?
So some of the things that came up, I think, in the previous panel were really, really interesting around women artists and artists, Black artists, taking part in the production of the text and the liner notes and the total packaging of their project. Free education, of course, right? Free music education. Some of those other initiatives are actually, I think, the in-between that gets us, you know, from the vision piece to the outcome of a changed culture and society.
I was working this past year on a series for University of California, Santa Cruz called Visualizing Abolition, which was an arts symposium series, which we ended up doing online, of course. And when we found out it was going to be online, I took advantage of my connections and I texted Terri Lyne and asked her if she'd be willing to have a conversation about becoming our musical curator, which she did very generously, and brought us an amazing group of musicians who all wrote original compositions and produced videos for the series. And I say this because I want to talk about a particular contribution between Diane Reeves and Camila Cortina Bale, who just graduated from the Institute and wrote an amazing composition that they performed together for the series. And the kinds of responses we're getting from people about those videos, but especially about that one, are incredible. And I think it indicates the work that the Institute is doing and how it will actually be a vehicle to help ensure that this music not only is relevant, but intervenes in what's happening with popular music. So this is exciting work that the Institute is already doing and that I'm so happy to be a part of.
It seems that collaboration is actually one of the key motifs that the Institute can really sort of use to, again, expand the genre, expand the form, expand the field, and also expand some of these underlying ideas that are part of the key thematics. You know, I wanted to get back to that early question because Gina brought up something that relates about jazz. You know, so you said something like jazz, what is that? And sort of what is it now? How would you all posit an interpretation of jazz that does let it sit in other provinces, that helps people in other domains understand its deep underpinnings of knowledge?
I remember doing this crazy drive. I was in Europe someplace. I decided I was going to get in my car and I was just going to drive. And I wanted to photograph these things. And in my tape player was this wonderful conversation, an interview, early interview from the 1990s with Toni Morrison. And she was talking about jazz, her book, Jazz. And at the core of it was this idea of a great democracy, that within jazz is this extraordinary level of creativity, improvisation, and freedom, and the ability to take risk. and that indeed freedom is the ability to take risk. And that within jazz, right, within jazz as a form, right, its improvisational form is the ability to take risk while on stage, playing live in front of an audience or by yourself, right? But that ability to play in the ground, to see what can be found and to be discovered either by yourself or within a group. Jazz without patriarchy, I think, is the is this par excellence, right? It is the ability to take risk at a moment that we are attempting to search out and to feather out for ourselves a new sense of possibility in a new future through music and sound and possibility. And this idea, you know, going back to what Gina was talking about, her project, the work itself is democratic. The work itself expands the notion of freedom. The practice itself expands the notion of freedom. I hope that the work that I'm doing, the way that I hold convenings and that I bring people together, musicians, dancers, poets, actors, singers, performers together, performing all on the same stage, mixing on the same stage, right? is my desperate sense to realize the possibility of the impossible.
I think it's an opportunity to dig a little bit deeper into something you mentioned earlier, and I think Farah mentioned or implied as well, the gender piece of this, right, in this moment, and how the institution is going to both think about that as an operative element and an inoperative element at moments, or, you know, to claim and then not claim, and, you know, just... Can we have a conversation a little bit about what is a really important shift and move in so much of our thinking and the ideation around that piece? And yet how I think we do want to absolutely consider a dynamic relationship of its possession and dispossession.
And I'm picking up on something that came up in the chat, which I want to emphasize, the concept of entelechy. Was given in the chat and basically referring to the organic emergence of something into its essence, right? So that people talk about that in terms of jazz, in terms of it becoming itself over time, organically through improvisation and through the exchange and through the collaboration. But we're talking also about impediments to that entelechy that are now built into its history. And so, as I said before, we can't go back and undo that harm, but we can think from now.
Yeah, such a great point. And I think what you put forth here is the also cataloging and creating a repository for those impediments to some of this coming to the fore, right? So I think, again, a location for that, or at least an opportunity to call some of that out, is equally important. If there were an opportunity to add some other things alongside jazz, gender justice, Black feminism, what are some of the other themes? And they've already been sort of implied here, but what would be some of the other themes that might be put into this context and to help kind of round out some of, or really kind of open up what's taking place or what will take place through the Institute?
I feel like this is all about a journey toward freedom, right? We're talking about the possibility. This is why the term justice is so important. And, you know, that freedom is important for us to think through in the sense that we don't want to determine what it would look like or what it sounds like or what it is. But we do want to say something about what practices, and this is something that Terri Lyne always asks us to emphasize and to speak through, since it's part of our work, the Black feminist principles that have undergirded the Institute and that are structuring today, both in the relationship, the generous relationships that people are exhibiting. I'm watching the glorious chat and the conversations from earlier. which are really exemplary of the way of working that will allow us to arrive at that.
You know, it's the placement or the speaking freedom in place of, or in lieu of, or along with justice is exactly what I was getting to. Just how we can kind of use justice, of course, is an important and appropriate kind of placement there in the kind of moniker for the Institute and so many of the projects. But I think also to call out explicitly freedom as kind of one of the key, you know, the operation there that we are trying to get to, that you're trying to get to is great. What would be some of your versions of those fantasies around any of the operations? So I think one of the moves for the institution is to think about transformative pedagogical strategies.
What does it mean to bring in musicians as thinkers? Mm-hmm. How does, you know, my colleague George Lewis talks a lot about improvisation as a practice, and looking closely at improvisation, not only as a musical practice, but as a way of life, all right, as a way of thinking, as a way of collaborating.
So I'm kind of imagining a new classroom in which, you know, we teach philosophy or we teach theory, but at the same time, we bring music in to disrupt our sense of being, you know, siloed in this one particular kind of form. That's perhaps something that the Institute for Jazz and Gender Justice can explore. We don't know. And I think that's what's so exciting, that we don't have the kind of agenda with points that we'll tick off as we accomplish them. We learn as we move along a trajectory that, you know, hopefully is taking us to a better place.
Eliciting methodology that has to do with disrupting some of what academia does to us. You know, people are often more about making sure they preserve their words and they publish their words and that we're into the certain kind of product. But the ephemerality and the necessary experimentation and improvisation that I've always learned from the music is really important. And I think it's also connected to, Romi, something you said about the artists being thinkers and makers, because what I think we should probably say here is that not every artist is also a thinker, and not every musician is also a thinker. And so what we're trying to lift up is a different way of being in the music and in the world. And it doesn't mean that that other way is a wrong way or a bad way, but I do think that our role is to emphasize and lift up the critical intelligences that are at work in challenging through whatever modality. And that's the work that I find most joyful and most meaningful.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that Terri Lyne and the Institute are, you know, in really, really great hands with the advisory that will come from you all in all these levels, and think, you know, the kind of, you know, deep thought, the ideation, the sort of actionable measures and metrics that can shift some of this, and the ability to produce, you know, again, alternatives, new models, complications, all of that's come up in the conversation, I think really points to what we were really intention to think about today, which is sort of some of the vision and perspective that comes from the advisory group. So thank you. It's been really, really great to sit with you. Nichole Rustin earned a PhD in American Studies from New York University and a GD from the University of Virginia. She is an assistant professor in residence of race and ethnicity studies at the Rhode Island School of Design. Nichole is working on a new book project exploring how artists use the law as their medium and how law frames art. Her book, The Kind of Man I Am, Jazz Masculinity in the World of Charles Mingus Jr., is a cultural history of gender and jazz in the post-war period through the life and work of Charles Mingus. Nichole is co-editor with Sherry Tucker of Big Ears, Listening for Gender and Jazz Studies, the first anthology of work in jazz and gender studies. She is co-editor with Nicholas Gebert and Tony Whiten of the Rutledge Companion to Jazz Studies, an anthology of cross-disciplinary and transnational studies in jazz. In addition, her work has been published in Critical Sociology, Jazz Debates, Radical History Review, Bill Taylor, Trailer, William Edmondson, and the Modernist Impulse, William and Mary Bill of Rights Journal, South Atlantic Quarterly, and Organizing Black America. So I think this is the moment for Nichole Rustin.
Wow, thank you so much, Romi, for that introduction. And I'm so thrilled and kind of I'm overwhelmed in a great way, in an energized way, to follow the advisory board and this really fantastic discussion about what it means to think about jazz and gender justice. Terri Lyne has mentioned at the beginning of the panel this afternoon, what is the idea of accountability, right? Accountability is not just about making amends, but it is also about standing up when called, recognizing that one has to be engaged in taking on the responsibility, and that it's all of our responsibility to be accountable and to be accountable for the vision that we want to see in the world. To think about the question of gender within jazz, I mean, my primary work has been in jazz studies, has been about thinking about masculinity. And in particular, you know, I've written about Mingus, someone who kind of, on the one hand, embodies kind of all of the bogeys of masculinity, one might say, but also one who is struggling, I think, against those narratives. And I think the idea that we have to embrace, and I think the Institute embraces, as we've seen through our discussion, is that gender is not one thing, right? It doesn't speak to the experiences of just one type of person. And so what does it mean to think more expansively and differently about gender, and how does that gendered identity sit on a continuum as opposed to a binary, right? That are we always just thinking in terms of masculinity or femininity? How do we take away the social, why do we take away the social experience and want to just limit it to a binary idea? In its ideal form, jazz is a space that cultivates an ethics of care and responsibility. As we've seen in our repeated engagements, thinking about Jerry Allen and Terri Lyne is one about relationships. It's about creating and cultivating and developing relationships so that the music flourishes, so that the music, we can take risks within the music. I think what was so interesting is that we've also come to see that the work doesn't just have to live within an institutional framework, right? That it can happen both in the formal setting, but also in those relationships, those meetings over text, you know, that Farah talked about, like being available and accessible.
I think to wrap our brains around trying to create music that speaks to the future and speaks, it's not really just focused on, you know, looking at the problems, looking at the past, reflecting on what's happening in the present, how to do that in music. And I know earlier, I think Jeannie or Angela, one of you, no, I think it was Angela, mentioned Nichole Mitchell. I think she might even be on this Zoom, but just, you know, that type of futurist way of approaching music. And so that's one of the, that's the, you know, that's kind of the obvious, you know, the obvious way I can try to talk to students about it. So I'm definitely looking to, you know, anybody, all of you and anyone else to help, you know, bring other ideas about how to talk to students about creating music that reflects that kind of progressive mindset.
Whenever you as an artist begin to create something new, you're creating something that has a connection with past music expressions, but it's also very new. It's something that has never existed in the world before. And I mean, this is why I think that artists and musicians are really the best people to provide a kind of leadership to those of us who don't engage in those kinds of imaginative practices all the time. I often tell the story about Nina Simone visiting me in jail. She was so concerned that she did not have all of the knowledge she thought she needed to participate in the movement. So she's asking me to give her a book list of you know, all the books she should read. And this is what I told her then, that she's done far more to inspire people to get involved. Mississippi Goddamn did the work of a million books, right? And so that she should be aware of the fact that through her talents and her brilliance, she was offering something to the movement that was immeasurable.
This institute is being the first one that's explicitly kind of feminist, Black feminist in its motivations, as building upon that trajectory. The very fact that I can say that suggests that it's not easy work, right? That it's hard work and that we make inroads each time we commit ourselves to a project like this. And so I think that we are building on a foundation that is constantly challenged the hegemony of white male critics and scholars in the music, and that we will continue to do so and make innovations and inroads in that project. I'm curious to hear what Nichole thinks.
I still feel like there are spaces where it hasn't trickled down all the way that it needs to, right? And to think about how this is something that comes up regularly, how like in the middle school and high school scene, you know, how is there a place for young girls and teenage girls, and how do we get those people who are teaching in those spaces to know this work? And but on the other hand, that's some future-oriented work as well, because we who are here teaching now will hopefully influence how music teachers engage with the work.
I'm wondering whether any of today's panelists are familiar with Maya Cunningham's recent work at the UMass Black Music Project. In a recent lecture, she argues that distinct gender roles, with women associated more with vocal role and men with instrumental playing, are characteristic of many traditional Afro-diasporic musical cultures. I'd be interested in hearing your thoughts on this perspective, which seems to be oriented more toward respect and understanding of past realities than toward present-day advocacy for justice and equality. Can it be productively reconciled with the work of the Institute?
There are two tiers of work that we have to do about past realities. One is to acknowledge that, yes, the woman is vocalist, you know, with male instrumentalists is a model. And that is one that might be shared across African diasporic cultures. And that, like what Angela said, it's not a model where there is a hierarchy, but where there is a communication and a kind of influence across the board. I just finished writing a small piece on the relationship between Billie Holiday and Lester Young, and how all these movies want to hook Billie Holiday up with these romantic leads that didn't exist. But if we can look at, you know, a relationship that was really important, the relationship with Lester Young, and listen to that relationship, where she's trying to sound like him and she's talking like him, you know, and he's trying to sound like her, and she says, "I can hear the lyrics when he plays," that there's a lot for us to learn about that relationship between between the male instrumentalist, or when Miles talks about, like Angela said, learning how to phrase Porgy, listening to Billie Holiday, or learning about space by listening to Shirley Horn, right? So that's one thing. That's one part of the past that, yes, I think we can talk about it. And then there's also an understanding of the past that says that not all the women were vocalists, right? That there were also women instrumentalists. And I think that a lot of times, you know, and not saying that there's anything wrong with women vocalists, and that we need to transform our understanding of the role that they played, but that they are also these women instrumentalists as well. And that they have contributions and, you know, that they're contributing to that conversation, and that some of them are experiencing sexism. A lot of them are experiencing sexism, and a lot of them are also experiencing, you know, some Melba Liston and Randy Weston.
Well, and there's not a whole lot for me to add other than thank you again. I love all of you. You're all so inspiring, and I do appreciate having you on speed dial, at least most of you. Now I have hopefully made a few more friends that I can, you know, put in my phone to text, because I appreciate Farah saying that earlier, that, you know, whether we've formally had a meeting or not, the access is always there, and we're always communicating. And that's kind of how things are done these days, right? So thank you to all of you.